Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents A Field Guide to Grad School, Uncovering the Hidden Curriculum by Jessica McCrory Calarco, narrated by Marie Jenkins. Publisher's note: in this audio edition, you will hear references to templates, tables, appendices, and other resources present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Introduction. What does it mean to write a literature review? Who should you choose for your dissertation committee, and how should you ask for their help? How big should a conference poster be? If a journal tells you to revise and resubmit, should you celebrate or cry? These are the kinds of things you'll need to know to be successful in grad school, but they probably won't be covered in class. Instead, they're part of the hidden curriculum, the things you're expected to know or do, but won't be explicitly taught. Of course, that begs questions. If the knowledge and skills and strategies in the hidden curriculum matter for success, why are they hidden at all? Why not just make them part of the formal, i.e., explicitly taught, curriculum instead? The hidden curriculum of grad school stays hidden in part because it's taken for granted. Unlike the formal curriculum, which tends to focus on ways of thinking, the hidden curriculum tends to involve ways of doing, how to do, write about, and talk about research, how to navigate complex bureaucracies, and how to ask others for help when you feel lost. Those ways of doing are easy to take for granted because once scholars learn them, they enact them in subconscious ways. And once those ways of doing are taken for granted, they become a lot harder to teach. Think, for example, about your grandma's blueberry pie or whatever favorite dish you have that a friend or relative makes. Your grandma probably doesn't follow a recipe, and if she tried to tell you the recipe, there's a good chance she couldn't easily tell you exactly what she does. Essentially, the taken-for-grantedness of your grandma's pie-baking knowledge can make it hard for her to share that knowledge with you, which makes it hard for you to recreate her pie for yourself. That same taken-for-grantedness works to keep the hidden knowledge of academia hidden as well. Like your grandma with her pie, your professors are experts in the kind of work they do. After doing that work for many years, or decades, your professors can do it almost without thinking. As a result, they might forget that the hidden curriculum is hidden. They might forget there was a time when they didn't know how to do what they do. They might forget that you don't know what they've spent a career learning. They might struggle to explain what they know in a way that makes it easy to understand. Taken-for-grantedness, however, isn't the only reason the hidden curriculum of academia stays hidden. Rather, the hidden curriculum also stays hidden because professors have little incentive to uncover that knowledge for their students. In academia, and especially in departments with graduate programs, the big rewards, grants, publications, jobs, tenure, promotions, and awards go to scholars who do prolific, prestigious research. Doing that kind of research takes a tremendous amount of time and energy. Meanwhile, being a good teacher and a good mentor, the kind of teacher and mentor who systematically uncovers the hidden curriculum of grad school for their students, also takes a tremendous amount of time and energy. But exerting that time and energy doesn't come with external rewards. Because of that incentive structure, professors have a tough choice to make. Professors can focus on research, chase the big rewards, but they probably won't have the time or energy left over to give you hands-on support. Professors can also focus on teaching and mentoring, provide a high level of hands-on support, but they probably won't have the time to do the research they need to be successful in their careers. And, of course, professors can try to be great at all these things, but that probably means working themselves to exhaustion, putting their health and their career and their relationships at risk. Ultimately, then, the hidden curriculum tends to stay hidden, and that hiddenness perpetuates inequalities in grad school and in academia as a whole. Grad students from more privileged groups, for example, those who are white, affluent, male, cisgender, heterosexual, native-born, and able-bodied, tend to reap more of the big rewards in academia. They're more likely to get into top programs, get chosen for top fellowships and top grants, get their research published in top journals, get hired for top jobs, and get tenured to keep those top jobs. Of course, grad students from privileged groups don't get those big rewards because they're smarter or work harder. They get them because of how they are perceived by key gatekeepers, because they typically have access to more resources, and because they have an advantage in learning the hidden knowledge they need to succeed. Privileged students' advantage in learning the hidden curriculum is, in part, a network advantage. If you're from a more privileged background, you probably have friends or family members who've been to grad school. Those friends and family members can be your guides to grad school. They can help you uncover the hidden curriculum for yourself. Meanwhile, if you're not from a privileged background, then you probably can't rely on your close friends and family members to help you navigate the hidden curriculum of grad school. You might even face criticism from friends and family about the demands of grad school or the type of person you've become. That lack of support, in turn, can make it harder to succeed. Privileged students' advantage in learning the hidden curriculum is also an entitlement advantage. If you're from a more privileged group, you're probably pretty comfortable talking with your professors and asking them for help. When you've asked for things in the past, your teachers and professors have probably said yes, and those yeses have probably made it easy to feel entitled to support. Of course, you might have encountered one or two professors who were too intimidating to approach for help, or you might have had a professor who denied your request. But if you're a student from a more privileged background, you probably didn't have to worry about whether your professor said no because of who you are. Meanwhile, if you're not from a privileged background, you might find it more difficult to ask professors for help. Professors, like all people, are prone to subconscious biases. Given that possibility of bias, you might worry about how your professors will judge you for needing help. You might worry that if a professor sees you as difficult or demanding, they won't want to invest in you or your career. Essentially, students from privileged groups have an advantage in learning the hidden curriculum, and that advantage helps those students to be more successful in their careers. If you're a student from a less privileged group, you probably think those advantages are deeply unfair, and you're probably not alone. In the United States, the average grad student is still a white male student from an affluent, highly educated family. But the face of that average student is changing. Between 2000 and 2016, the number of graduate students in the United States increased from 2.2 million to 3 million, and those increases were concentrated almost entirely among students from systematically marginalized groups. That includes low-income students, first-generation college students, students of color, LGBTQ students, women students, especially in STEM fields, and international students. If you're a student from one of those groups, you might need a little extra help navigating the hidden curriculum of grad school. And that's okay, because you deserve success as much as those students who came in knowing the hidden curriculum of grad school, or who have more resources to figure it out on their own. At the same time, it's important to consider who you ask for help. In most schools, departments, and disciplines, the people who work hardest to help grad students succeed are professors from systematically marginalized groups and especially women faculty of color. Because of their commitment to making academia a more diverse, inclusive, and equitable space, professors from systematically marginalized groups often take it upon themselves to provide the kind of hands-on guidance students need. In doing so, however, they often put their own careers and even their own health at risk. And those are the professors academia needs the most. Tweet from Nina M. Flores, PhD. Hashtag hidden curriculum around hashtag grad school is real, especially for first-gen students. First year in college, I had no clue about grad school. I remember the embarrassment of trying to figure out if I was an undergrad or grad. All I knew is I wanted to graduate, so I selected graduate. I can still feel the shame of not knowing the difference between graduate and undergraduate status as a freshman in college, but with no one who had this basic inside knowledge about hashtag higher ed in my life, how would I have known this intuitively? I wouldn't have, and I didn't. If we want to avoid overburdening professors from marginalized groups, we have to find another way to help students uncover the hidden curriculum and get the guidance they need to succeed. Arguably, the best solution would be to make the hidden curriculum part of the formal curriculum. Graduate programs could explicitly teach students, all students, everything they need to succeed. That's certainly something I'm working toward in my own department. Maybe someday it'll be something you can work toward in yours. Those changes are important, but they also take time. In the short term, my hope, as a sociologist who studies inequalities in education, as a professor who cares deeply about quality teaching and mentoring, and as someone who struggled, and sometimes still struggles, to understand academia, is that this book will be your field guide to grad school. In it, I uncover key parts of the hidden curriculum. I also offer strategies to help you build the confidence you'll need to uncover the rest for yourself. Along those lines, it's important to note up front that some aspects of the hidden curriculum vary across disciplines, across departments, and across degrees. Essentially, what you need to know to be successful in a doctoral program in sociology at Stanford is going to be somewhat different from what you need to know if you're getting a master's degree in computer science at Oklahoma State. Given those variations, a book like this one is not easy to write. I'm coming at this as a social scientist, and that's the part of academia I know best. While this book also includes material relevant to the humanities and lab sciences, there will inevitably be things I forget to mention and things I don't discuss in the level of detail you need. That said, I do my best to uncover as much of the hidden curriculum as I can, given the limits of my own knowledge and the limits imposed by the publishing process. More on that in Chapter 8. To do that, I focus on the parts of the hidden curriculum that apply widely across disciplines, departments, and degrees. At the same time, I also point out key sources of variation in the hidden curriculum and offer suggestions on how to look for, ask for, and ultimately get help with uncovering the parts of the hidden curriculum that are unique to your discipline, your department, and your degree. Specifically, we'll talk about the hidden curriculum as it relates to applying to and choosing a program, building your team, deciphering academic jargon, reading and writing about other people's research, staying on track in your program, doing research and finding funding, writing about research, publishing and promoting your work, talking about your research and surviving the Q&A, going to conferences without breaking the bank, navigating the job market, balancing teaching, research, service, and life. In these chapters, I share my own, sometimes embarrassing, stories from grad school and post-grad school, and I share stories that others, including current grad students, former grad students, and other professors, have shared on Twitter as part of a larger discussion of the hashtag hidden curriculum of grad school. Essentially, we'll uncover the hidden curriculum of grad school by talking openly and honestly about the things we didn't know. I also share resources like email templates, writing outlines, and checklists, which can also be viewed in the print and ebook versions of this book, that can help make grad school feel less like getting locked out when everyone else has the key. This includes resources I've created to help my own students navigate the hidden curriculum of grad school and resources that other scholars and organizations have created to support their students and scholars as well. Tweet from Jess Calarco. The hashtag hidden curriculum of academia isn't just hidden from undergrads, it's hidden from grad students too. I'm sure we all had things we were embarrassed we didn't know in grad school, so let's tell those stories. I'll go first. Parentheses, one of many. Tweet from Kristen K. Smith. Just told an undergrad about graduate assistantships, stipends, and tuition waivers. Her mind was blown. We need to do a better job educating students about hashtag grad student opportunities, especially for rural, low-income, non-traditional students. Hashtag higher ed. My hope is that this field guide to grad school will take some of the stress out of navigating the hidden curriculum, that it will leave you with more time and energy to pursue the passions that brought you to grad school, that it will help you feel confident in yourself and your worth as a scholar. In grad school, feeling confident is critical because the hidden curriculum is a perfect catalyst for self-doubt. When you're struggling to navigate the hidden curriculum, it can feel as though everyone else solved the puzzle while you're still finding the pieces. Essentially, the hidden curriculum contributes to imposter syndrome, that feeling that you're not good enough or smart enough to be in your program, that maybe you got into grad school by mistake. Tweet from Jess Calarco. This is such an important conversation. Acknowledging the hashtag hidden curriculum seems like the first step in combating imposter syndrome, helping students recognize that there are things that matter for success that aren't always explicitly taught, and then making those explicit. Tweet from Liana Sayer. Discussing hashtag hidden curriculum in ProSem and curious about strategies to quell hashtag imposter syndrome. Mine of staying silent isn't effective. At Jessica Calarco, at Sarah Burgard, at Sarah Damask, at Family Unequal, at Tristan B., PhD. If you've struggled with imposter syndrome, you know the toll it can take on your physical and mental health. Research has found that grad students experience strikingly high rates of depression and anxiety, much higher than among the general population. Those health problems also appear to be closely linked to grad students' feeling of inadequacy, the kind of inadequacy you might feel when you can't see the hidden curriculum and you feel like you're being tested on things you never learned. As a field guide to grad school, this book can help you fight off those self-doubts. As you listen, you'll learn you're not the only one who's felt confused or inadequate or alone in grad school. Far from it. You'll learn key parts of the hidden knowledge you need to succeed. And you'll learn strategies that can help you be more confident in asking for the help you need to figure out the rest. Chapter 1. Choosing a Program. Tweet from Devin Cantwell. I was talking to some folks I knew from high school tonight, and they were really surprised to learn that there was even such a thing as a fully funded PhD program. We are all from low-income backgrounds and knew very few people who ever went to grad school. Hashtag hidden curriculum. You think you might want to go to grad school, but how do you decide? And even if you know you want to go to grad school, how do you decide which program to choose? Some people go to grad school because they're not sure what else to do, but I don't think that's the best approach. Given the time, effort, costs, and trade-offs involved, you should go to grad school only if it'll help you achieve your career goals and only if it won't break the bank or your spirit in the process. Essentially, it's important not to treat grad school as an end in itself. Instead, going to grad school is more like packing for a trip, where the destination is the job you want to do with your degree. If your ideal trip is a month in Paris, you might want to learn some French, and you might need a passport and visa before you go. If instead you want to spend a week hiking in the Appalachian Mountains, Taking French classes would be a waste of time and money. Meanwhile, if you don't have a solid pair of boots, a fully stocked backpack, and key survival skills, there's a good chance you won't last the whole week, or worse, that you'll get hurt along the way. Like different destinations, different careers require different tools, knowledge, and credentials. You want to choose a program that can get you where you want to go. To put these decisions in context, let me tell you a bit about my own path to grad school. As an undergrad, I worked as a research assistant for an education historian. I got to help edit a book manuscript, and I even got to do research in the National Archives in Washington, D.C. That taste of real academic research, plus my love for college classes more generally, had me hooked. I didn't just want to work for a college professor, I wanted to be one myself. At the time, though, I had no idea how to actually become a college professor. No one in my family, or even my extended family, had ever gotten a doctoral degree. I was lucky, though, in that my undergrad professors noticed my passion for research and encouraged me to consider grad school. At first, I was hesitant. I didn't know anything about doctoral programs, and my dad really wanted me to go to law school instead. He saw law school as a clear path to a stable, well-paid career. But I wanted to do research, and I wanted to teach. So, eventually, after a number of incredibly helpful conversations with my undergraduate professors and lots of research online, I decided to take the GRE, a standardized admissions test for grad school, and apply to doctoral programs. At the time, I was double majoring in sociology and education studies, and I was interested in researching inequalities in schools. Given those interests, I initially looked into doctoral programs in education. However, when I mentioned this to my undergrad professors, including one in sociology and two in education studies, they all urged me to consider a doctoral degree in sociology instead. With a doctoral degree in education, my job prospects, at least in academia, would be limited to schools of education. With a doctoral degree in sociology, I'd have more options, including both sociology departments and education schools. That's because disciplinary departments, for example, sociology, history, biology, typically hire only scholars trained in those disciplines. For identity and status reasons, those disciplinary departments tend to view scholars trained in interdisciplinary programs as lacking the expertise to teach in a disciplinary program. Meanwhile, interdisciplinary schools and programs, for example, education, public health, public policy, and administration, hire a bigger mix of scholars, including some trained in disciplinary departments and others with interdisciplinary degrees. Those conversations helped me navigate the complexities of academic culture. They helped me figure out what I couldn't have figured out on my own. That's what I hope to do in this chapter, help you identify key factors to consider when deciding whether to go to grad school, what kind of degree to pursue, and which program to choose. We'll talk about matching your degree to your career goals, distinguishing different degrees and programs, and choosing a program that meets your short-term and long-term needs. Finally, we'll talk about how to apply, how to boost your GRE scores, and how to cope if your grades and scores aren't as high as you want them to be, how to write a strong personal statement and how to tailor it for each program on your list, how to ask for letters, and how to respond if you get asked to write them yourself. Matching your degree to your career goals. When one of my undergraduate students tells me they're interested in grad school, the first question I ask is, "What do you want to do after grad school?" The answer to that question will determine what kind of degree you should get and whether you should go to grad school at all. As we'll talk about more in the next section, different degrees and non-degree certificates serve as credentials for different types of careers. If you want to teach chemistry at a school like the University of Chicago, you will almost certainly need a doctoral degree. If you want to be a public policy analyst at a think tank, or if you want to be a school social worker, a master's degree is probably all you'll need. And if you want a high-paying job in computer and information systems management, an internship during college might open more doors than a graduate degree. So, how do you figure out which kind of degree you'll need for the career you want? If you've already graduated and started working, you may have reached the limits of what you can achieve with just a bachelor's degree, and you might be looking to grad school to help you move up the ladder in your field. If that's the case, then I'd recommend talking with some of the higher-ups in your organization about their experiences in grad school and what degrees and programs they'd recommend you try to pursue. If you're still an undergrad, or if you're working but interested in switching fields, then I'd suggest starting your grad search process by thinking about your career role models, people whose careers you'd love to have yourself. It might be someone you know, like a favorite college professor, or the director of the nonprofit you volunteered with in college. Or it might be someone you know of, like an economist you saw interviewed on TV. Once you have the names of a few potential role models, you can start doing some research. It might feel a bit like stalking, but that's why websites like LinkedIn exist, so don't feel weird. Academics, people who teach and or do research in college or university settings, Google each other's research and websites and CVs all the time. CV stands for curriculum vitae, which is basically the academic version of a resume. More on academic jargon in Chapter 3. Look up where your role models went to school, what degrees they earned, and what jobs they had before they got to where they are today. Then, ideally, do a little triangulation. Find other people working in similar positions and look up their career trajectories as well. That'll give you a sense of whether you need a degree, and if so, what kind of degree you need to get to where you want to be. Now, you might not have a specific career role model in mind. Instead, you might have a sense of the kind of career you want. Maybe one involving research, or writing, or marketing, or product design. Maybe you want a career where you're working directly with people and making a difference in their lives. Maybe you're worried about the environment and climate change. Maybe you like working with numbers. Or maybe you love listening to podcasts about politics and policy. A visit or an email to the Career Services office at your undergraduate college or university can help you link those interests to potential careers and possibly put you in touch with alumni who work in those fields. Even if you have already graduated, they'll be able to help you think through various career options that match your interests and possibly connect you with alumni who can tell you more. Remember, the career services people have an interest in helping you because if you get a good job, the university can brag about you in its stats, and you'll probably be more likely to donate money to the university someday too. Along those lines, there are lots of careers that require, or at least increasingly require, graduate degrees. There are the obvious grad school-linked careers, like college professor and research scientist. Beyond that, though, you might also need, or at least benefit from having, a graduate degree if you want a high-level career in a field like public policy, market research, pharmaceutical development and testing, nonprofit management, computer science and engineering, marriage and family therapy, social work, criminology, biostatistics, financial analysis, public relations, human resources, information science, database administration, and so many more. As you're wading through various career options, trying to make sense of people's resumes and CVs, you'll probably encounter lots of acronyms, things like MSW and MBA and PhD. In the next section, we'll talk about what all those letters mean. We'll also talk about why it's not just the letters that matter, but also, at least for many careers, the school that granted the degree. Essentially, once you figure out what degree you'll need for the job you want, it's time to find a program that offers that type of degree or non-degree you'll need. Considering your options. Grad school isn't just one thing. There are non-degree programs, master's programs, and doctoral programs, and they differ in important ways. The primary thing to consider in choosing among those programs is what you want to achieve career-wise by going to grad school. Beyond that, though, you'll also want to think about the amount of time it'll take you to complete these different programs and the amount of money you'll have to spend and forego in the process. Non-degree programs. Some programs and schools offer certificates, badges, and other micro-credentials that will, at least in theory, bolster your job-related skills or make you more appealing to potential employers. For example, if you want to learn the business side of publishing and connect to important players in the industry, the Columbia Publishing Course at Columbia University is a 6-week summer program that can give you a leg up in your career. Or maybe you've finished an MD degree and you're interested in doing research, but you don't want to get a PhD. Then something like Brown University's certificate program in clinical and translational research might be a good fit. Or if you already have a career in research or business, but you need more advanced skills to do the kind of work you want to do, then the University of North Carolina's Data Analytics Bootcamp might be worth considering. High-quality non-degree programs have the potential to make graduate training more accessible, more affordable, and more diverse, especially since many of these programs are offered online or with night and weekend classes designed for working professionals. In reality, however, few programs achieve that goal, and some predatory programs are intentionally designed to take your money without doing anything for your career. Given the problems with many non-degree programs, this book focuses on master's and doctoral degree programs instead. That said, if you decide that a non-degree program is the best option for you, please proceed with caution. Ask lots of questions. Talk to people who've completed the program. Opt for public and non-profit options over for-profit schools. Master's degrees. Master's degree programs generally involve an extra 1 or 2 years of education beyond a bachelor's degree. In some fields, that extra training can help you get out of an entry-level job and give you a shot at getting the corner office someday. In other fields, those extra 1 or 2 years might mean the difference between a job and no job at all. Master's degrees also come in lots of flavors. If you're interested in the social sciences or humanities, for example, English, history, political science, Middle Eastern studies, then you'll probably get a Master of Arts MA degree. If instead you're interested in the lab sciences and related fields, for example, physics, chemistry, computer science, mathematics, then you'll probably want to look into Master of Science MS degrees. Some fields also have their own specialized master's degrees, like an MPH in public health, an MFA in fine art, an MSW in social work, or an MBA in business. Whatever field you're pursuing, it's important to distinguish 4+1 programs and standalone, or terminal, master's programs from those that build into a doctoral degree. 4+1 programs. If you're still an undergraduate student, you might be able to get your master's degree through a 4+1 program at your current school. These programs typically involve completing an additional year of coursework beyond your bachelor's degree and also completing a master's project. In most cases, that extra year of training has to be completed in the same field where you're getting your bachelor's degree. Terminal masters. The idea of a terminal master's sounds kind of ominous, but basically, this just means that you're getting a master's degree without the immediate intention of getting a doctoral degree. More on doctoral degrees in a minute. The 4+1 programs just described are one way to get a terminal master's, but if you're out of undergrad, or you want to switch schools or fields of study, you can apply to terminal master's programs at other schools or in other departments instead. This might be the option for you if you're interested in jobs that require just a master's, or if a standalone master's will give you a better shot at getting into your top choice doctoral program. Non-terminal masters. A non-terminal master's is a stepping stone on the path to a doctoral degree. In some fields and programs, it's possible to get a doctoral degree without first finishing a master's. In other fields and programs, you will earn a master's degree as part of the doctoral program. That kind of master's degree is considered non-terminal in that you continue in the same field at the same university after finishing your master's degree. Doctoral degrees. If you want a career in academia or a career in research more generally, a doctoral degree might be the degree for you. Not all doctoral degree recipients go on to careers in academia, though, as we'll talk about in Chapter 11, and not all scholars who teach or do research in academia have doctoral degrees. As with master's degrees, doctoral degrees come in many flavors. One of the most common is the PhD, or Doctor of Philosophy degree. Like the Master of Arts degree, the name here is a bit misleading. Philosophy isn't the only field in which you can get a PhD. Rather, there are PhD programs in mathematics, art history, education, physics, even nursing. There are also non-PhD doctoral programs, such as the Ed.D. in education, the J.D. in law, and the D.O.S., or Doctor of Science degree. Depending on your discipline, you might spend 3 or 4 years getting a doctoral degree, or you might spend 9 or 10. The length varies across disciplines. The physical sciences, life sciences, earth sciences, engineering, and mathematics tend to have the shortest time to degree, 6 years on average. The social sciences are a little longer, 8 years on average, and the arts and humanities are the longest, 9 years on average. Given those differences, you might assume arts and humanities students just aren't as motivated or as focused on getting their dissertation done, but those time differences are really a function of differences in how grad programs are structured. If you're in an arts, humanities, or social science program, for example, you'll probably have more required coursework than you would in a lab science program, which can add an extra year or more. And you'll probably also have to develop an independent dissertation project, which can take a considerable amount of time, especially since you'll probably have to wait to start your dissertation research until after you've done your coursework and qualifying exams. If you're in a lab science discipline, on the other hand, there's generally less required coursework, which can shorten the time to degree. In many lab science disciplines, your dissertation will most likely stem from your work on one of your advisor's projects, rather than a project you develop and carry out yourself. And you'll typically be able to get started on that dissertation research fairly early in your program, rather than having to wait until after you've done your coursework and exams. All those factors together can lead to a much shorter time to degree. Distinguishing degrees and programs, money and status. Once you figure out what degree you'll need for the job you want, you'll need to find a program that offers that type of degree. There will likely be hundreds of programs that fit the bill. So, how do you narrow the list and decide where to apply? First, look at the price tag. Then, look at whether the potential value of the degree is worth the cost. Funding considerations. The cost of grad school can feel especially daunting for students who left college with substantial student debt. If you're one of those students, you're definitely not alone, and you might be worried about taking on even more debt to pay for grad school. That's why it's important to consider the financial costs and the short-term and long-term financial benefits associated with different degrees. Master's funding. Professional master's programs, for example, MBA, MSW, MPH, and other terminal master's programs typically are not funded. This means you'll be responsible for paying the full cost of tuition, fees, and living expenses, and those costs can add up quickly, even over 1 or 2 years. Those costs are particularly high at private universities. The one-year Master of Arts program in the Social Sciences at the University of Chicago, for example, requires that students take 9 courses at a cost of more than $60,000, and that's not including living expenses, books, laptops, and other basic needs. Public universities and online master's programs can be a more affordable option, especially if you're an in-state student, i.e., a resident of the state where the school is located. Tuition and fees for the 16-month Master of Social Work, MSW, degree at the University of Michigan, for example, costs about $48,000 for Michigan residents who have already completed a bachelor's degree in social work. For an out-of-state student with a bachelor's degree in social work, that same degree will cost more than $72,000. If you're looking to cut costs further, you might look for programs that offer scholarships for master's students. That said, scholarships for master's students are relatively rare and seldom cover the full cost of tuition and fees. That's because, in the context of limited taxpayer funding for higher education, many universities and departments use their terminal master's programs to help make ends meet. In those programs, students pay the full cost of getting their degree. Of course, you might not be able to afford $60,000 or $72,000 for a degree, and you might not be able to rely on your family to help. If that's the case, then getting a terminal master's degree will probably mean finding your own scholarship. More on this in a minute. Taking out loans, or possibly asking your employer to help you fund some of the costs. Doctoral funding. Unlike terminal master's programs, many doctoral programs provide some level of funding for students. In many PhD programs, for example, you'll pay only a portion of the total tuition and fees, and you might even get a stipend from the university, a small salary to live on while you're getting your degree. That's because PhD programs are usually designed to train future university professors. Given the income that professors typically earn, most would struggle to pay off the loans from an unfunded doctoral degree. Doctoral students, and especially PhD students, also provide a source of low-cost labor for departments and universities. If you go that route, you'll probably be expected to work as a teaching or research assistant, or even teach your own classes in exchange for financial support in getting your degree. This also explains why professional doctoral programs, like a JD in law or an MD in medicine, are funded more like terminal master's degrees. If you're a student in one of those programs, you don't typically do any service for the university, so you pay the full cost of your degree. That said, while most doctoral programs do provide some level of funding support for students, there are also huge variations in how much funding you'll get and what you'll have to do to get it. These are variations across universities, across different degrees and disciplines, and sometimes even across different students in the same program. Some of those variations relate to the number of years of funding you'll get and whether that funding comes with any guarantees. In some programs, for example, and especially programs in the lab sciences, your training is probably funded through grants your advisor got from outside agencies. That means that if your advisor's funding dries up, yours does too. And that's why, as we'll talk about more in Chapter 6, it's important to ask lots of questions up front about how long your advisor's funding will last and what happens if that funding runs out before you finish your degree. In other programs, and especially programs in the arts, sciences, and humanities, your training is paid for by the department, rather than through grants to individual faculty members. In those programs, you'll typically be offered a funding package that includes a set number of years of guaranteed funding. You might, for example, be offered full funding, for 4 or 5 or 6 years. This means the department will pay some portion of your tuition and fees and sometimes provide a stipend for living expenses during those years. If you don't finish your doctoral degree within the funded years, you'll probably stop getting a stipend, if you got one in the first place, and you might have to pay for, or find grant funding to pay for, any additional years of tuition and fees. There are also variations in the size of the stipend you might get in grad school, if you get one at all. Prestigious private universities, for example, generally offer bigger stipends than public universities and smaller private colleges because they have larger endowments and charge higher tuition at the undergraduate and master's level, and because they use some of that money to fund doctoral training programs. Programs in science and technology generally offer larger stipends than do programs in the social sciences, arts, and humanities because they bring in more external grant funding and also because students in those fields often face higher opportunity costs in terms of foregone salary in pursuing their degrees. Some students, in turn, may also receive higher stipends than other members of their cohorts, either as part of a recruitment bonus or because their advisors have more grant funding to use for graduate stipends. A third source of variation in doctoral funding relates to the work you'll have to do to earn your stipend. Your funding package might come with non-service years, years where you get funding without doing any research or teaching-related service for the department. Or you might have to work as a research assistant, a teaching assistant, or an instructor every year unless you get outside funding to cover your costs. We'll talk more about teaching and research assistantships in chapters 5 and 6. Even fully funded graduate programs won't necessarily provide the level of financial support you'll need to make ends meet. If you have a high level of financial responsibility, young children or siblings or parents to support, you might find yourself looking for supplemental income while you're getting your degree. As we'll talk about in Chapter 5, some programs will let you do hourly work for professors to earn extra money, but that's not the case everywhere. Your program might have rules against extra work, and if you're an international student, you might be legally prohibited from doing any paid work on the side. Grants and fellowship programs. Given the limits of grad school funding, you might be interested in looking for programs where you'll have a higher likelihood of getting grants or fellowships to help cover your costs and possibly give you a higher stipend as well. With a few key exceptions, you can apply for graduate fellowships and grants only after you've been admitted to grad school. When you're considering various programs, however, it can be helpful to look for programs where students have a track record of success in getting supplemental support. Specifically, I'd recommend checking out the web pages of current students. You can usually find links on the program webpage, and looking for information about the fellowships, grants, and other financial support they've received. You can also look at the web pages for various government agencies and foundations that fund graduate-level grants and fellowships and see where most of their recipients are getting their degrees. To get you started in that search, here's a list of a few particularly notable scholarship and fellowship programs that fund students and early career scholars from a wide array of universities and disciplines. The National Science Foundation, NSF. NSF Graduate Research Fellowship Program, GRFP. NSF Doctoral Dissertation Research Improvement Grants. NSF Career Program. The National Institutes of Health, NIH. NIH Training and Career Development Grants. NIH Dissertation Awards. NIH Career Development, K, Awards. The U.S. Department of State's Fulbright Programs. The Marshall Scholarship. The Rhodes Scholarship. The NAED / Spencer Dissertation Fellowship Program. the William T. Grant Scholars Program. The Robert Wood Johnson Foundation Health Policy Fellows Program. Some funding agencies also provide dedicated support for grad students and scholars from systematically marginalized groups. Those include the Ford Foundation Fellowship Programs, the Alfred P. Sloan Foundation Graduate Scholarship Programs, American Academy of University Women, American Fellowships, Career Development Grants, International Fellowships, Selected Professions Fellowship, Research Publication Grant in Engineering, Medicine, and Science, the U.S. Department of Education's Jacob K. Javits Fellowship Program. When you're looking into various programs and checking out the web pages of current students, you might see some of these big-name grants and fellowships listed, and you might also see other university or discipline-specific fellowships and grants listed as well. That's because, and as we'll talk about more in Chapter 6, there's a huge array of funding sources for graduate students and early career scholars. Some grants and fellowships are internal, funded by the department or the university, while others are external, funded by an outside organization. Some cover the full cost of your graduate education, for example, stipend, tuition, and fees, while others cover only specific research-related expenses, for example, equipment, payments to study participants, transcription costs, data access costs, conference and travel costs, or publishing-related expenses like submission fees and page fees. Sometimes that extra money adds on to your existing funding. In other cases, your scholarship or fellowship substitutes for funding you would have gotten from your advisor or department, or it fills gaps in years where you otherwise would have had no funding at all. Like I said, we'll talk more about finding and applying for these opportunities in Chapter 6. At the application stage, though, the key is to get a sense of whether the programs you're considering have been successful in helping students get the financial support they need. Status considerations. Money should matter in your decision about whether and where to go to grad school, but it's not the only important thing. It seems crass, but if the end game is to get a good job, and especially if the kind of job you want is an academic job, i.e. teaching, and/or doing research in a college or university setting, you'll also want to think about status as well. Some grad programs, for example, are more highly ranked than others. The idea of program rankings generally refers to the U.S. News and World Report rankings. Every year, U.S. News and World Report publishes a list of what it considers the best graduate programs in various fields. What counts as best, though, is highly subjective, as the rankings are based on surveys that ask faculty to rate the, quote, academic quality of other programs in their field. Of course, even highly subjective rankings can carry real weight. The name of the school on your diploma can affect your chances of getting funding, getting your research published, and even getting a job. In the academic job market, for example, there are far fewer tenure-track positions than applicants who want those jobs. That's because universities pay tenured and tenure-track faculty more than lecturers, adjuncts, and grad students, even when they're teaching the same course. And they typically pay the same amount for teaching that course, whether it enrolls 7 students, 70, or 700. Thus, when budgets are tight, it makes fiscal sense for universities to hire fewer tenure-track faculty members and offer larger classes and more classes taught by non-tenure-track instructors instead. Unfortunately, however, and because the demand for most tenured-track jobs exceeds the supply, universities can be very selective about whom they hire. In that kind of tight job market, employers tend to opt for job candidates with elite pedigrees. Distinguishing degrees and programs. meeting your personal needs. Figuring out what kind of degree you need for the career you want is the first step in narrowing the list of possible grad programs. The second step in narrowing that list is eliminating the programs that are too costly or not well known enough to make them worth the time and effort you'll spend getting a degree. Even at that point, though, there might still be 2 or 3 dozen programs to which you could reasonably apply. So, how do you narrow the list from there? Arguably, you should narrow the list to eliminate those programs that won't meet your personal needs. No amount of money or status is worth being miserable for many years, so you'll want to look for programs that offer both high-quality training and a high quality of life. People and programs. People, and the training, mentoring, and support those people can provide, are particularly important to consider in choosing where to get your degree. That includes the people in the program, potential advisors, other professors, staff members, and fellow graduate students. It also includes people in the community. Having friends and being part of organizations outside of academia can make grad school feel a bit less isolating and a bit less stifling. We'll talk more about interacting with advisors, professors, and other grad students in Chapter 2. For now, though, here are a few things to consider, people-wise, in choosing a program. Advisors. Different disciplines and different departments do advising in different ways. If you're applying for a doctoral program in a lab science field, you'll probably apply to work with, and for, a particular professor, who will then serve as your advisor. If you're instead applying for doctoral programs in the social sciences, arts, and humanities, or if you're applying for a terminal master's program, you'll probably apply to the program as a whole, and then either choose or be assigned an advisor once you get there. You can usually figure out which type of program you're applying to by looking at how graduate students are listed on the department website, i.e., whether they are grouped by lab/advisor, or listed more generally. If you're not sure, you can also email the professor or staff member in charge of the graduate program. They're usually listed on the department website as the graduate chair or director of graduate studies to ask. Regardless of whether you're interested in programs with lab model advising or those with non-lab-based advisor-student relationships, there are a few key factors to consider in narrowing down the list. First, you'll want to identify potential advisors who are active in teaching and research. Second, you'll want to look for potential advisors whose expertise aligns with your interests. It doesn't have to be a perfect match, but it does have to be close enough that your advisor can reasonably advise you on the kind of work you want to do. Third, you'll want to look for potential advisors who aren't likely to leave before you finish your degree. Some universities, for example, have a track record of not granting tenure to assistant professors, and especially those from systematically marginalized groups. If you're applying to one of those schools, you'll want to think carefully about whom you choose as your primary advisor. If your advisor is denied tenure or leaves for other reasons, you might have the option of following your advisor to their new school, but you might have to switch advisors instead. That's not to say, though, that you should avoid assistant professors as potential mentors. Because of their proximity to grad school, assistant professors are often among the most caring mentors for grad students, and they can be tremendous role models, especially if you're considering careers in academia. So far, we've talked about the importance of finding an advisor who's a good professional match for you and the kind of work you want to do. But what makes a good advisor isn't just found on their CV. You'll want to look for advisors who are easy to talk to, who give timely, constructive feedback, who aren't already overburdened with a huge number of students, and who are willing to invest in your career. And you'll have to do some digging, contacting potential advisors, talking to their current grad students, and asking strategic questions during visit days to find out which of your potential advisors fits those bills as well. Other professors. While you'll probably have one primary advisor in grad school, no one person can be your go-to mentor for every aspect of your career. Instead, you'll want to develop strong relationships with at least 4 or 5 faculty members as you work toward your degree. That doesn't mean, however, that you need to find a program with 5 professors who all do exactly the kind of work you hope to do. That program probably doesn't exist, and if it did, it might leave you feeling a little stifled. Instead, as we'll talk more about in Chapter 5, you should choose a program with a team of faculty members who can collectively and cooperatively meet your professional and personal needs. Other grad students. Some programs admit 1 or 2 grad students every year. Others admit 10 or 20 or more. Having a cohort, i.e., a group of fellow students entering the program at the same time, is really helpful. That's because grad school can be disorienting. You're usually moving to a new place and taking on new responsibilities, and because having people to talk to, especially if those people are in a similar situation, can make it a little bit less so. That said, large cohorts also create competition for attention and support from faculty, for coveted research and teaching positions, for funding and for awards. When considering potential grad programs, take a look at their websites. You'll probably be able to find lists of current grad students with links to their bios or CVs. Calculate, roughly, how many students they admit every year. Calculate the faculty-to-student ratio. Make note of which students are winning awards and getting fellowships and publications, i.e., is it the same handful over and over, or are those rewards more evenly distributed? Look for evidence of grad students collaborating with faculty members on projects and collaborating with each other as well. Those details can give you a sense of whether the culture among grad students is more collaborative or competitive. As we'll talk about more in Chapter 2, you don't need to be best friends with the other students in your program, but it can also be hard if you don't have any peers to turn to for support. Location. In terms of geographical considerations, it's important to keep in mind that where you live in grad school might not be where you end up long term. For example, if you're getting a doctoral degree and you want an academic career, you'll probably have to change cities when you finish your degree. That's because most universities and departments won't hire their own grad students as faculty members, at least not in the first few years after graduation. To give another example, maybe you're interested in getting a master's in public policy analysis and getting a job at a policy research center. Only 1 of the top 10 ranked master's programs in public policy analysis in the United States is located in Washington, D.C. And yet, D.C. is a huge hub for policy research. So, if you get an MPP degree elsewhere, you might end up having to move to get the job you want to do with your degree. If you're probably going to have to relocate after grad school, it can sometimes be worth it to go, quite literally, outside your comfort zone to get your degree. Grad school can be a great opportunity to explore a different city, a different region of the country, or even a different part of the world. That choice, however, does come with risks. U.S. sociologist Dr. Brooke Harrington, for example, studies tax havens. In 2017, while she was working at a university in Denmark, Harrington was hit with criminal charges. Why? Because she presented her research to the Danish parliament, something she was invited to do. Now, this might seem ridiculous, but Danish officials were cracking down on immigrants who were engaged in unauthorized work activities. Harrington's work permit allowed her to do work only for the university, and Denmark's officials decided she was breaking the rules. In the United States, meanwhile, and in the wake of President Donald Trump's travel ban on visitors from primarily Muslim countries, some graduate students and scholars were left stranded outside the United States and unable to return, and others were unable to travel home to see their families. Of course, these stories are troubling. But the point is to say that in the context of systemic racism and anti-immigrant sentiments, it's important to consider the risks that go along with living outside your comfort zone, even if only for a short time. Those risks, unfortunately, go beyond just the legal and logistical and include risks to your physical and mental health. On some campuses, for example, you might be more likely to encounter racist or sexist or anti-immigrant or anti-LGBTQ attitudes. In those spaces, you might also be more likely to experience mistreatment because of other people's biases toward people like you. That mistreatment sometimes comes in the form of questions like, "Where are you really from?" or comments like, "You did better than I thought you would on this assignment." In other cases, mistreatment happens when people assume you don't belong, such as when a white student called the police on a black Yale graduate student who was taking a nap in her dorm's common room. These microaggressions might seem inconsequential, but research shows they can have a serious negative impact on your physical and mental health and overall quality of life. Of course, microaggressions and other forms of mistreatment can happen anywhere, from big cities to small towns and everywhere in between. And yet, some programs, universities, and local communities have cultures that are more toxic than others. Along those lines, and before committing to a grad program, it's important to do your homework and find out as much as you can about what life is like there for people like you. Reach out to current students in the program. Ask about their experiences, how they've been treated by faculty, by fellow students, and by people in the community. Ask whether students like them have a history of leaving before finishing their degree. Getting that information up front can help you make informed choices about where to apply. Or, if you decide to enroll anyway, having that information in hand can help you be better prepared for the challenges you might face and push you to find a network of people and organizations who can help support you in being resilient to those challenges. More on this in Chapter 2. Geographical considerations, however, aren't just about local culture. Rather, in deciding where to go to grad school, you might have other concerns that limit your options geographically. Maybe you have a spouse or partner whose job tethers them to your current city. Maybe you have young children who don't want to leave their friends or their schools. Maybe you have a medical condition that requires specialized treatment or an elderly family member who needs regular care. In that case, you might have to think strategically about what types of degrees and programs you can consider based on the types of jobs you can get locally after you get your degree. Location is also closely linked to cost of living, and that might be something you have to consider when choosing a program as well. For me, cost was a big factor. I applied to 10 PhD programs in sociology and got admitted to 4: NYU, Stanford, the University of Chicago, and the University of Pennsylvania. All 4 were ranked in the top 15 PhD programs in sociology. All 4 had great professors and great students, and all 4 offered similar amounts and types of funding. Given those similarities, and after a lot of deliberation, I ended up choosing the program that would cost me the least in the end. Going to Penn meant that I could live with my parents, who live about an hour outside of Philadelphia by train. Those cost savings also meant that I could afford to buy a car, which I needed for my dissertation fieldwork, and also made it easier to visit my partner, now spouse, who was living and working in Washington, D.C. Of course, making a choice based on location can also come with trade-offs. Because of where I lived in grad school, I spent a lot of time commuting, sometimes 20 hours a week. And while some of that commuting time was productive, I got a lot of writing done on buses and trains, it meant I spent very little non-class time on campus. I didn't go out for drinks with my grad school friends or hang out with them on the weekends. I didn't linger after class to talk about theory or strategize about conference submissions. And once I was in the field full-time doing research for my dissertation, I didn't always make it to department events. Given how geography matters, and for each program you're considering, you should probably ask yourself, Will I have to move after grad school to get the kind of job I want? Will I be able to afford to live there for as long as it'll take to get my degree? Will I be able to handle being this far from, or close to, key people in my life? Will living in this place cause me to face regular threats to my well-being? Will I be able to find a community to help me deal with the challenges I face? Ultimately, you might decide to take some risks or make some trade-offs on location in the short term, but if being in a particular location matters to you, that's okay too, and you shouldn't be ashamed for letting it factor into your choice, because, as we'll talk about more in the next section, grad school is much more tolerable and potentially even enjoyable if it isn't your whole life. Work-life balance. Along those lines, there's this idea that grad students and academics more generally are supposed to love their work, and there is, at least in theory, a lot to like about grad school. The opportunity to spend time reading and learning and thinking and talking about new ideas, the flexibility to work when and where are best for you, and the freedom to do research that matches your own interests and that might make a difference in other people's lives. But that work as passion model also comes with problems. It can make you feel pressured to work all the time. It can make you feel guilty about taking time off or having interests that don't perfectly align with your academic work. A recent article in Times Higher Education included quotes from various academics about their guilty pleasures, which included things like traveling and watching comedy movies. Presumably, the article was intended to show that academics have lives and passions outside of research and teaching, but by framing those hobbies and interests as guilty pleasures, the article implied that academics should feel guilty about doing anything not connected to their work. As a grad student, you don't have to accept the work-is-life culture. You don't have to work all the time, and there's a good chance you'll be more productive if you take breaks and if you have hobbies and interests that have nothing to do with work. I run almost every morning. I try to leave work by 4 or 4:30 so I can spend the afternoon with my kids. On the weekends, I rarely get much work done. With two little kids, Saturdays and Sundays are always packed with birthday parties and craft projects and grocery shopping and making dinners for the week. And while I sometimes get my laptop back out in the evenings to answer emails or finish a proposal or give students feedback on their work, I try to spend most of that time with my spouse or doing laundry or watching the latest Netflix shows. Pushing back against the work-is-life culture is harder in some programs than in others. In the department where I teach, it's rare for faculty to be in the office past 5 or 6 o'clock. Our department also has softball and indoor soccer teams, along with regular picnics and happy hours and other non-academic events. Not all programs work that way, and that's why it's important to ask lots of questions up front. Ask current grad students and faculty about how many hours they work. Ask what they do for fun. Look for a program where you'll be able to thrive both intellectually and personally. Of course, even if you do find a program where grad students and faculty have a good balance between work and non-work life, it's hard to fully escape the publish or perish pressure of an academic career. We'll talk more about managing those pressures in Chapter 12, but it's important to say here that if you're worried about adjusting to the intense work pressures of grad school, you're definitely not alone. Adjusting to the work-is-life culture of academia is challenging, especially if you're not going straight to grad school after finishing your undergrad degree. If you've graduated and started working, you might have a 9-to-5 job where you leave work at work, and it might take you a while to get used to the grad school routine. The transition from full-time work to grad school can be financially hard, too, particularly if you're taking a big pay cut or self-funding your degree. That's why, as we talked about at the beginning of the chapter, it's important to think strategically about the decision to go to grad school and about whether you really need an extra degree. It's also why it's important to do some number crunching up front. you'll want to figure out whether you'll be able to afford your degree and whether the ultimate payoff will be worth it in the end. Selectivity. So far, we've talked about narrowing the list of programs to which you will apply, but as you probably know from undergrad, applying doesn't guarantee you'll get in. Many programs, and especially prestigious, well-funded doctoral programs, are highly selective. They admit only a small fraction of the students who apply. That means you have to think strategically in choosing your final list. In general, I recommend applying to 2 or 3 "there's a slim chance I can get in here" programs, 3 to 5 "there's a decent chance I can get in here" programs, and 1 or 2 "there's a very good chance I can get in here" programs. But how do you figure out which programs fall in each category? If you're applying to grad school in the United States, the U.S. News and World Report websites can give you a general sense of the average student admitted by each school. Some grad program websites will also include information about the students they usually admit. That includes GRE scores, though some programs are moving away from requiring the GRE, GPAs, and information about the kinds of experience or credentials incoming students generally have. You can also do a little digging and check out the CVs of students recently admitted to the program. Look at where they went to college, whether they won awards or wrote honors theses, and whether they got any additional training, like a certificate or terminal master's, or had work experience before pursuing their current graduate degree. After you finish scouring the web, I'd recommend reaching out to some of your professors from undergrad, and especially those in the field where you're planning to apply. Your professors probably have friends or former grad school colleagues at a range of universities across the country or even around the world, and they can probably give you more inside information about those various programs than you'd ever find online. Ideally, your professors will also know you and your interests and your strengths, and they'll be able to help you figure out where you'll be both happiest and most likely to get in. So, once you identify 2 or 3 professors who might have some good insights, how do you ask them for help? First, I'd recommend making a list of programs you'd be interested in attending. Next, drop your professors an email, maybe something like this. "Dear Professor, insert last name. I hope all is well with you. Since we last chatted, I've been," insert brief update on where you are in school, for example, working on my honors thesis, or what you've been doing work-wise post-degree, for example, working in market research. "I'm writing to see if you would be willing to chat with me about applying to," insert master's, doctoral, "programs in," insert field. "I've made a list of programs I'd be interested in attending, see below, and I would be grateful for your help identifying which of these programs would give me the best chances of admission. For context, my undergraduate major is, / was, insert major. My GPA is, / was, insert GPA. My GRE scores are," insert GRE scores. "I am interested in studying," insert brief description of the research topic / question you hope to focus on in grad school. "And I," insert do or do not, "have prior research experience." If you have prior research experience, briefly explain here. "I would appreciate any advice you can provide, and I would be happy to meet in person or talk by email or by phone. That said, I'm sure you are very busy, and I completely understand if you are unable to help at this time. Best," insert your name. Insert list of schools ranked in order of your preference. These conversations with your current or former professors can also give you a chance to ask for letters of recommendation, which you'll ultimately need as part of your grad school applications. And that's where we'll turn next, covering the various components of the application and how to put it all together. Applying to grad school. Once you've narrowed down your list of potential programs, start putting together the materials you'll need to apply. The parts of an application vary across disciplines, departments, and degrees, but you'll generally need completed application forms, application fees, personal statement, writing sample or samples, GRE scores, undergraduate transcript, letters of recommendation. A few suggestions about key parts of the application. Application fees. Be ready for sticker shock. Each application you submit might cost up to $100 or sometimes more. Programs use these fees to bolster their budgets and to make sure only serious students apply. Even with those application fees, top programs might get hundreds of applications each year, and the Graduate Admissions Committee, which is generally made up of program faculty, has to review all those applications. Those committee members have plenty of other work to do, and having an admission fee can, at least in theory, keep the number of applications from getting out of control. That said, if you don't have the money to pay those fees, don't feel like you can't apply. Many programs offer fee waivers for students with limited resources. If you don't see information about fee waivers on the Graduate Admissions website for the department where you're applying, you can reach out to the Graduate Program Chair or Director or members of the Admissions Committee and ask them if your fees can be waived. You might have to complete a separate application for a fee waiver and provide additional financial documentation, but if your request is granted, it can save you a lot of money in the end. Personal statement. This is your chance to make your case for admission. It should be clear, concise, and tailored to each program, giving the admissions committee a clear sense of 1. Why you're interested in grad school. Even though this is a personal statement, you don't have to tell your life story, but you should give the admissions a sense of what brought you to grad school. That could be a specific research question, a specific career goal, or a passion for teaching. You should also give them a sense of what you hope to achieve while you're there. For example, doing research on a particular topic, acquiring critical skills, building your professional networks, etc. This part of the personal statement should be roughly a paragraph long. 2. Why you're going to be successful in grad school, especially if you've struggled in the past. For better or for worse, and as sociologist Dr. Julie Posselt explains in Inside Graduate Admissions, grad programs, especially doctoral programs, like to make sure bets. They want to invest in students they perceive to have high chances of success, because when their students are successful, the program looks good. Unfortunately, that practice of picking students who seem like sure bets has the effect of increasing inequalities in grad school and in academia more generally. That's because, despite their proclaimed interest in supporting diversity in grad school and in academia, members of graduate admissions committees sometimes find themselves relying.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.